Good evening, everyone. It's a real pleasure to be with all of you. I really thank God to see the good work that God has begun in each one of you, and I pray that in some way, in some measure, you'll be blessed today. So I want to begin with Psalm 139. Psalm 139. These are well-known verses. 139 from 13 onwards. For you created my inmost parts, you wove me in my mother's womb. I will give thanks to you because I'm awesomely and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works, and my soul knows it very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in secret and skillfully formed in the depths of the earth. Your eyes have seen my formless substance, and in your book were written all the days that were ordained for me, when as yet there was not one of them. How precious also are your thoughts for me, God! How vast is the sum of them! Were I to count them, they would outnumber the sand. When I awake, I am still with you. These verses are speaking about how precious we are in God's sight. And one of the things that all young people, even when I was young, I struggled with the way God had made me. We all feel, that, had I been fair, or if my eyes were blue, or maybe my nose was not the way it was, or maybe I should have been more intelligent, then I would have gotten to IIT or, some fancy college. Or if I was born in some other family, all these things come at us. This is primarily because, when Adam and Eve fell, they lost that acceptance that they had with God. And we all have this insecurity, or this feeling that we are not adequate, that we are not good enough. And were we different in some way, then our lives would have been better. But once we are born again, and once we are grafted into God's family, one of the most wonderful thing that happens and should happen, if it has not happened, then it must happen, is that you are absolutely assured that you are wonderfully made, no matter how you may look to others, or how others may perceive you, or what even sometimes your parents may have, or your siblings, or your friends may have told about you. That is not, what matters. What matters is the word of God, that God has made each one of you awesomely and wonderfully. And this should give us great assurance in our hearts that we are precious to God, that God loves us. Yeah, and one of the ways to find out whether we are established in this truth is how quickly we get disturbed when a comment or something that happens in our life shakes our confidence, that we begin to doubt. That means that we are not established. We may know these scriptures, but they have not become revelation, and they have not entered into our deepest part, which is our heart. And that is what God wants each one of us to know. We must be absolutely sure that God loves us, and that we are wonderfully made, and we are precious in God's sight. And also in this verse, in these verses, it says God has planned every single day for each one of us, even before even one one day came to pass. And, you know, he has a plan for each one of our lives. And that is the most wonderful plan that, you know, we can ever, ever imagine. And the other thing is that God is full of love towards us, that his thoughts towards us are all of peace and love and prosperity, that God wants us to prosper, not just materially, okay, but spiritually primarily, that God wants us to become, you know, his ambassadors in this world. He wants us to be the light, as Jesus said, you are the light and you are the salt, that we, wherever we go, we carry the presence of God. And that can happen only when we refuse to listen to the negative voices. You know, we must refuse to listen to the negative voices of, you know, discouragement, discontentment, and those type of thoughts. When they come, we must go in the presence of God and cling to the word of God and claim the promises that are there in the Bible. I want you to, you know, turn, if you have your Bibles, I hope you have your Bibles, John chapter 1, verses 12 and 13. It says, "But as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God, to those who believe in his name, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God." You know, when we are born again, we are part of God's family. God is our Father. And that is one of the most amazing truths. Even though, you know, a lot of times you may have heard this. And if any one of you is not born again, I would really urge you to surrender your life to Jesus and, you know, and accept him as your personal Lord and Savior, because, you know, life completely changes. I mean, what an awesome privilege that we have, that we are the children of the Most High God. I mean, nothing in this world can compare. You know, God is the one who rules the entire universe. Just imagine if your dad was the ruler of your state or something. How secure you'll be, how assured you'll be in your heart that, you know, nothing can happen to me. I mean, nobody can threaten me, or nobody can shake me. You know, I am absolutely secure. But, you know, much more than the ruler of the state, or, you know, a governor or a chief minister, God controls everything. It is one thing to, you know this truth in our head, but it's quite another to be established in our heart. And, you know, I pray that you will really go to God and get this assurance yourself, because you know, we can hear a lot of messages, and we can even read a lot of text, but God has to give that revelation. God has to make it real in our lives. And when that happens, you know, things are completely different. I mean, you get a new mind, you get a new outlook, you get a new spring in your step. There is a twinkle in your eye. You can be confident that, you know, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me. Like David, he said in Psalm 23, surely, surely, you know, and that is what even again, John says in 1 John chapter 3, verses 1 and 2, see how great a love the Father, I'm reading from 1 John chapter 3, verses 1 and 2. See how great a love the Father has given us, that we would be called children of God. And in fact, we are. For this reason, the world does not know us, because it did not know him. Beloved, now we are children of God, I just pray that all of you will take this to heart, because the times that we are living in, lot of shaking is going to come. Jesus said, the Bible says that God is going to shake everything, and only those who are founded or built on the rock, they will not be shaken. And in Matthew, I think 26 or 25, where Jesus talks about the end times, people will be fainting from the expectation of what is going to happen, fainting from fear. And when we are assured that we are children of the Most High God, we will be rooted and we won't be shaken. And this is again re-emphasized in Ephesians, Ephesians chapter 1 verses 3 to 4. It says, blessed be God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ, just as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we would be holy and blameless before him in love. So God has, chosen each. You are not here by accident, let me tell you. If you are here today and you're listening to this word, God has in his mercy determined that you should hear this wonderful gospel truth, which is that God has chosen you before the foundation of the world. I mean, with our minds, with our logic, we cannot comprehend. God is like an ocean, and our mind is like a teaspoon. But the only people who get great things from God are those who take him in faith. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. And we must believe that God exists, that we are not some random accident or some evolutionary beings. God has created each one of us that we should know him. And you all, I don't know how to express this, but you all are so privileged to know these truths from such a early age. And if you take these things very seriously in your lives, you can become a force in the kingdom of God. You can be an instrument in God's hands, and your life can will you will not only be a blessing to yourself. I mean, you will not only be blessed, but through you, so many people can be blessed. And now the thing is, you might question, if I am a child of God, then why am I going through so many difficult situations? Why is my boss or my job so uncomfortable, or my boss is not giving me a raise or a promotion, or why, these people don't understand me, or I don't know. Each one of you will have unique situations and circumstances. But I want to tell you something. If you are established that you are God's child and God's got a great plan for you, then God will take us through difficult situations, because soldiers are not trained in comfortable beds and sofas. People whom God wants to do wonderful things in their lives, they have to be trained and tested through many, many situations. And so if you are going through difficult situations, praise the Lord. I mean, God has a plan, and you are in the center of God's will. Don't get discouraged. Just hold on. Claim the word of God. Just stay connected. Just as somebody prayed at the beginning, give us the Holy Spirit, the power of the Holy Spirit. And God will never, never let you down. I can tell you, 18 years since I'm following the Lord, it has not been easy. It has been very, very tough at times. But All through, I had this blessed assurance that my father is on the throne, and he will come through. So I'm not telling you a theory. I'm just telling you that if God has a plan, and God definitely has a plan for each one of you, and He will fulfill it if you first of all believe in Him, have faith, and then when you go through difficult situations in your lives, you will praise the Lord and you will thank God and you will ask Him to give you wisdom, because that is the other thing that is the most important thing for young people, is to acquire wisdom. The book of Proverbs is an amazing book. Here in Dubai, in our CFC Dubai, we are now having a Bible study on the book of Proverbs. And but there is a book by Brother Zach, and I would really recommend all of you, if you have not already read The Way of Wisdom. It is an amazing book, especially for young people. Proverbs, the book of Proverbs follows after the book of Psalms. In Psalms, you learn to praise God, to give thanksgiving, to sing and to pray, and it majors on that. It's more or less our connection with God. But the book of Proverbs, it gives us practical advice on how we are to deal with each other, how we relate to each other, how we act in wisdom, how we act in love. And this book speaks a lot about fools. 66 references are made on fools. And it talks a lot about laziness. Laziness, 28 references for laziness. And these are the two things, that as Christians, as young believers, we must be on our guard. Now, let me define what a fool is. Jesus also spoke about the wise virgins and the foolish virgins, the wise builders and the foolish builder. Fool, the definition of fool is not what we consider in worldly terms. You will call somebody a fool because maybe he doesn't score well in math or science or physics, or he's not good at studies. That is how the world equates fools and clever people. But in God's sight, a wise person is need not be an intelligent person. Intelligence is a gift that God gives us. The measure of intelligence that you have or I have is you didn't earn it, neither did I. It came as a gift, right? But the wisdom, godly wisdom, is how we behave in a godly manner. What is the divine way to respond to different situations in life? How does God expect each one of us to behave in our day-to-day lives, in our interaction with each other at home, in our workplaces, in our college or university, wherever? So that is very, very important, And the Bible tells us in the book of Proverbs, in the book of Proverbs, chapter 4, verses 5 to 9. Can anyone read Proverbs chapter 4, verses 5 to 9, if you have your Bibles? No one?
Please feel
Yeah.
free to read it. Please feel free. Proverbs 4.
Yes. Proverbs chapter 4, verses 5 to 9.
Proverbs chapter 4 verses 5 to 9. Get
Okay.
wisdom, get understanding. Do not forget my words or turn away from them. Do not forsake wisdom, and she will protect you. Love her, and she will watch over you. The beginning of wisdom is this: get wisdom, though it cost all you have. Get understanding, cherish her, and she will exalt you. Embrace her, and she will honor you. She will give you a garland to grace your head and present you with a glorious crown.
Thank you, Kevin. Wisdom is God is telling to acquire godly wisdom above everything else. You know, in the world, we think that those who are successful, those who are rich, those who have accumulated a lot of wealth, or those who are in high places, they are considered great. But in God's sight, if a person who is not seeking after God and godly ways, he's a fool. The Bible says a fool has said in his heart that there is no God. You know, we all are familiar with the story of the rich man and Lazarus. Now, the rich man went to church, you know that, or synagogue. But was he wise? No, he was a fool. Now, in worldly ways, he must have been an excellent businessman, or a good employee, or somebody who's very shrewd and clever. Because all of you know, to acquire wealth and to maintain it, you need to be smart in this world. But this rich man was not godly, and he didn't have God's wisdom, and that's why in the final analysis, he was a fool. So please remember that wisdom is different from intelligence. Wisdom is God's wisdom. First of all, it is available to all of you, all of us. When it comes to intelligence, some people, even though they may try very hard, you will not get into IIT or some fancy or top management or engineering institute. We all know that, right? Why? Because we just don't have the ability, even though we study 24 hours a day. A lot of people do that, and still they take 2 years off and still they don't qualify. But thank God that when it comes to acquiring wisdom, intelligence is not a criteria. All of us have equal opportunity to become wise in God's sight, to acquire wisdom. And the best thing is, if we seek after wisdom, all the other things, get added to us. All the needs that we have in our lives, God will throw in as a bonus. You don't have to run after those things. God knows that we need money, we need a house, we need education, we need food, we need medicine, we need insurance, we need all the things, because he's the one who created us, and he knows that we cannot survive in this world with those things. But the world is chasing after all those things, and in the world, people are always thinking how they can extract the most from the world in one earthly life. But God is looking for, when we become God's children, we follow in the footsteps of Jesus, and our attitude is, how much can God get the best out of us, and not the world, which says, what is the best I can get out of the world? And when we align ourselves with God, then there are numerous promises. I just want to take you through Proverbs chapter 2. It says, my son, if you will receive my words and treasure my, I'm reading from Proverbs chapter 2 verses 1 to 8. My son, if you will receive my words and treasure my commandments within you, make your ear attentive to wisdom, incline your heart to understanding. Verse 3, for if you cry out for insight and raise your voice for understanding, if you seek her as silver and search for her as for hidden treasures, then you will understand the fear of the Lord and discover the knowledge of God. For the Lord gives wisdom, from his mouth come knowledge and understanding. He stores up sound wisdom for the upright. He is a shield to those who walk in integrity, guarding the paths of justice, and he watches over the way of his godly ones. There is tremendous security. God, even though we can be very, very careful, there could be people scheming against us, which we cannot know. We are human beings, right? But God can protect us from all those wicked scheming. I've experienced that in my office. A lot of times, a lot of people try to harm me, backbite me and do all kinds of things, but nothing worked. Why? Because God is the one who watches over us, and he will protect us. He will thwart the plans of the wicked. We don't have to fight against other people. We are commanded to be wise, and God takes care of us. But there are three ifs. If you see, in this Proverbs chapter 2, it says, "My son." First of all, it is my son. Now, how do we acquire wisdom? First of all, we receive the words and treasure. Treasure. Treasure is something that all of us know. It's like precious money, gold, wealth, property. All those things in the world, no one is casual with it, right? We all are very, very particular about money and gold and property and all those things. So here it says, if we have the same attitude that we have towards money and all these valuable things, then the promise is for these type of people. And then it says in verse 3, "For if you cry out for insight and raise your voice for understanding." So the second condition is that we are not just casually skimming through the Bible. Okay, today I have to read my daily portion. So, okay, this uncle said to read from Proverbs. Let me just go through it. No. You go to the Bible with a cry in your heart, "Lord, I want to know you more. I want to understand your ways." And that is the type of a person that God is looking for. And if you seek her as silver and search for her as for hidden treasures, when there was a gold rush, I think in the 18th century, people discovered some place in Africa, and they would travel miles and take so much of pains, and many people would even lose their lives in searching for it. The Bible says that if we search for her as hidden treasures, that means first of all, I value God's commandments, God's word, and then I seek for her as I would seek for treasures. The best way that this came to me as the Holy Spirit telling me, the way you are so diligent about your work or your office, are you the same way diligent in seeking after me, after God's word, after a wisdom? That is the person that God will honor. And here it says, "Then you will understand the fear of the Lord." Fear of the Lord is something that we cannot just get it through our mind, or even by attending Bible studies or meetings. All those things will help us, but the Lord has to give it to us. The Lord has to give us wisdom. It says here, for the Lord, verse 6, "For the Lord gives wisdom." The Lord will give you wisdom. James, in the book of James, we read, if anyone lacks wisdom, he should ask God, and God will give us generously without finding fault. He will not find fault. He will not say, "Hey, you behaved, you were so wayward all these years. You never cared for me. Now get lost. No, I'm not going to help you." No. If we go to God sincerely and with a repentant heart, saying, "Lord, I need wisdom. I cannot, live this life with my human wisdom. I need your wisdom," then God is definitely going to help us, because God wants each one of us to acquire wisdom. You know, here it says in Psalms 90, Moses said, you know, after he lived almost 120 years, he says this. This is one of my favorite verses. Teach us, Psalms 90 verse 12, teach us to number our days that we may present to you a heart of wisdom. So God wants us to seek after him to get a heart of wisdom. Notice that it is not a mind of wisdom. It is a heart of wisdom. That means we are seeking to know God's heart. You know, God gave this wonderful certificate to David. He said, this is a man after my own heart. So God wants us to acquire wisdom. And godly wisdom, you know, all young people, not all, I won't say all young people, all people, I think they all, everyone on the face of this earth thinks they are very smart. You know, this is how we all are. But blessed is the man who does not trust in his own wisdom. You know, Proverbs chapter 3 and verse 5, it says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him and he will make your path straight. He will make your path straight. Do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and turn away from evil. You know, what is wisdom? Wisdom is staying away from evil. You know, much of evil in this world, especially now. I mean, all you young people are facing tremendous, tremendous challenge in terms of the internet and the social media, and the pressure that you're facing is enormous. And unless and until you go to God and ask for wisdom and seek for it, you know, with all your heart. If we think that, you know, we can manage, we can handle it, you will not be able to handle it. Only with God's wisdom, we can be overcomers. You know, God will, you know, our flesh is so weak. We are so, so weak. The older I grow, the more I realize that, you know, I'm so, so weak. If God does not help me, give me grace, I just cannot live this life. So I pray that, you know, all of you will seek after wisdom, and God will protect you. God will guard you. You know, in chapter 2, there are many, many promises. I just want to show you just one or two. You know, he says in Proverbs chapter 2, verse 8, you know, I'm reading from the Good News Translation. He protects those who treat others fairly and guards those who are devoted to him. So don't we all need protection in this world? God will protect us. You know, if we seek after wisdom, he's going to protect us. He's going to guard us. And verse 9 from the Living Bible, I want to read. It says, Proverbs chapter 2, verse 9, he shows us how to distinguish right from wrong, how to find the right decision every time. God will help us to find the right decision every time. You know, in life, there are many situations, like the other day, you know, I had a challenging email to respond. And now I can't turn to the Bible and see, okay, in Corinthians, is there a verse to reply? Because, you know, God has to give wisdom to us how we respond to people in the office, in our workplaces, you know, with our friends. Only God can help us. And if we are devoted to him, if we seek after godly wisdom, then you will be amazed at, you know, sometimes I have written a reply after seeking God, and I am surprised. You know, I read and I cannot believe after some time that, you know, I was the one who replied in such a way. I mean, in a godly way. And that to diffuse the tension in that situation. So I pray that you all will will seek after God and get godly wisdom. I think my time is up. So brother, think brother, what do you? You're
Yeah,
on mute.
you have anything else to say?
Yes, there were a couple of things, but I think I've completed 30 minutes.
Yeah, what I mean to say is you want to put one note, one point more.
Yeah, so one more thing, I want to show is from Proverbs chapter 2 and verse 12. 12, I'm reading from the Good News Translation. It says that it will prevent you from doing the wrong thing. They will keep you from people who stir up trouble by what they say. You will be able to know. There are some people, I'm sure all of you must have experienced. There are some people when they jump in a conversation, they have some provocative things to say, they will say some provocative things. And God, if we seek after God's wisdom, first of all, we will be able to discern the type of people that we are interacting with. And before that, we need to examine, am I this type of person that whenever I enter a conversation, I say something which upsets other people or causes, disturbance or unrest? We need to judge that. And God will help us to overcome that. And then He will also help us to discern the type of people you need to hang out with. Because, a bad company will prevent you from becoming godly. They will pull you, and you will not be able to resist them. So God will give you discernment which type of people you need to hang out with. Who is going to help you along your Christian life, and who you need to keep a distance. And also, God, young people, God will protect you from the adulteress, it says, from women who are who have who use flattery. They will say, "Oh, you're so handsome," or "you have such a nice dressing style," or some compliment to make you think that you are somebody great, and then trap you. Because we as young people, not even young, even older people, we all need to be on our guard against flirtatious women, people who are trying to seduce you. So you need to be on your guard. You need to preserve your purity. That is wisdom, because God, that is godly wisdom to preserve yourself in purity. And in these days, for young brothers especially, the need of the hour is to have a pure life, especially in the sexual area. So may God help all of you. Yeah, that's it, brother.